and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. I like to wish you all a happy feast of St Pishoy, the patron saint of this church. And St Pishoy, when actually we remember him, we remember two famous stories about St Pishoy. The first story, when a man visited him and he welcomed him and started to wash his feet. And then while he was washing his feet, he saw the wounds in his feet. So he knew that this person is the Lord Jesus Christ. And the second famous story about St Pishoy, when his disciples asked him, "We want to see the Lord Jesus Christ." So actually the Lord Jesus appointed a certain time that he would appear on the mountain on that time. And everyone got ready to go and meet the Lord Jesus Christ. And on the road, they found an old man who asked them to take him with them to see the Lord. But because everybody was busy and wanted to run quickly to see the Lord, so everybody actually denied the request of this person. Until St Pishoy came at the end and he offered to help this old man. But the old man was not able to walk, so he carried him, and he found that the weight of this man started to get heavier and heavier. And he continued carrying him. Then actually, he found that the weight of the man became lighter. And he heard a voice, "Blessed are you, Bishop, because you carried." Who carries heaven and earth? You carry God, who carries actually heaven and earth. And if you think about these two stories, we will find a common factor in these two stories: the love of Saint Pishoy to serve others. When he received this man, actually, he was practicing the virtue of welcoming the stranger. When he washed his feet, actually, he was doing this to give him rest from the long way. When he offered to help this old man, and not only to help him in walking, but to carry him over his shoulder, this also another example of how Antioch loved to serve others. And if we want to reflect deeply about these stories, we can see that when we serve one another, here only we will be able to see Christ in our life. St. Pishoy was able to see Christ when he welcomed this stranger and when he washed his feet. He was able to see Christ when he carried this old man on his shoulder and helped him in walking up to the mountain. So when actually serve one another, we will be able to see Christ. If you want to see Christ in your life, go and serve one another. And not only that, but others will see Christ in us when we serve them. So here, both the person who is serving and the person who is served, both of them will see Christ. The person who is serving, Christ will be revealed to him when he serves others. And those also whom we are serving will see Christ in us. The Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 25 elaborated on this when he separated between the sheep and the goats, and he put the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left hand. So he said to the sheep, the righteous, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous was surprised and told him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and we feed you, or thirsty and give you drink, or see you stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you?" And the Lord said, "Assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me." So, when we serve others, we will see Christ, and others also will see Christ in us. The Lord Jesus Christ himself set an example for all of us when he said, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve." He did not come to be served, but to serve. He set an example when he washed the feet of the disciples to teach us how to serve one another. Also, we can see in the life of all the saints, especially Saint Mary, her love to serve others. While she was a child in the temple, she was serving in the temple. And when she left the temple and received the Annunciation from Archangel Gabriel, and she heard about Elizabeth, she went fast to Elizabeth to serve her. Nobody asked her to go to Elizabeth, but her love to serve others. Serving one another actually is a command from God to all of us. When you read the scripture, you will find many verses that is using the word one another. Actually, in the New Testament, we have more than 50 verses that have the word one another, which means we have an obligation to one another. I serve you, and you serve me. We need one another. And God actually structured in this way, a structure that will be interdependent on one another, because this will strengthen the bond between all of us, the bond of love. You cannot serve, you cannot live in the world independently, because you need others in your life. So the interdependence here means I serve you and you serve me. When we serve one another, actually, this is considered wise wisdom and faithfulness in our stewardship. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 10, St. Peter said, as each one has received a gift, minister it means serve with it, minister it to one another as good steward of the manifold grace of God. God gave you gifts, and God gave me gifts. Why He gave each one of us gifts? Not for ourselves, not to serve ourselves with these gifts, but to serve one another. As each one has received a gift, ministering to one another as good steward of the manifold grace of God. And you know, the person who took the gift, the talent, and buried it, God called him wicked and lazy servant or steward. So when we take the gift of God, and instead of serving one another with the gift of God, we bury this gift or this talent, then before God, we will be lazy and wicked servant. St. Paul, in Hebrew chapter 13 and verse 16, consider serving one another like a sacrifice. He said, do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. When we do good to one another, when we do righteous acts to one another, and when we share what God has blessed us with, when we share with others, this is considered a sacrifice for God. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. God is well pleased. The early church also paid attention to the service. In Acts chapter 6, we read about the conflict that happened because the widows of the Hellenists were neglected in the daily distribution. And the disciples, they did not say, it's not our responsibility, we don't care, we should not pay attention to this. Actually, the disciples established a rank called the rank of the deaconate. And this rank, in order to pay attention to this service, the service of the needy. So when there was a complaint regarding how the widows of the Hellenists were neglected in the daily distribution, so immediately they reacted. The disciples said, therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom will he appoint over this business? Sometimes people come to us with a complaint. They need something in their life, but we don't pay attention to it. We don't react immediately as the disciples react. Or maybe sometimes we don't feel it is our responsibility. We feel only our responsibility just to preach and do Bible study, but not in the field of social service. And this is actually not right, because it is the responsibility of the church to also take care of the services that her children need. We hear about the Lord Jesus Christ, how he was wandering, traveling from place to place, healing every illness and every sickness and every weakness in the people. How, when the Lord Jesus Christ, after he preached 3 days, how he said to the disciples, give them something to eat. Don't let them go without eating, lest they faint in the way. Also, in the ministry of the apostles in the book of Acts, we see how St. Paul, when he heard about that there was a famine in Jerusalem, he actually collected money and sent it to the mother church in Jerusalem. So it is the responsibility of the church also to attend to the needs of the people, to attend to the sick, to go and visit them and pray for them and anoint them with oil and do for them the unction of the sick. It is the responsibility of the church, and not the church, it is all of us, because the church, it is the assembly of the believers, is to go and visit those who are in prison. It is our responsibility to go and visit them. We cannot hear about a person who is in prison and just return a deaf ear. Actually, those who are in prison, they are in a situation, because being imprisoned, they become actually ready to hear the word of God. And when we go and share with them the word of God, they will accept it. Many prisoners actually repented in prison when they heard the word of God. Also, we need to take care of their families, the families of those who are in prison. Either emotional support, spiritual support, financial support, we need to take care of their families. We need also to take care of the strangers. And maybe in our time, the newcomers are like strangers. So when we hear about a newcomer, how we should host him, try to help this family to be established quickly, and to share with them our experience without turning our back to them. When we do this, actually we are using our talents and we are making profit with our talents. When we do this, people will see Christ in us, and actually we will see Christ in them too. And let me tell you something. Many people, when they see a church serving them, and maybe this church is not an Orthodox church, they start to go and attend this church. Not because they compare between the doctrine and the dogmas of the Orthodox Church with other churches. Simply, they join other churches because this church helped them in their need. Help them when they come new to this country. Help them to find a job. Help them to be established. Help them when a person in this family was imprisoned. Help them when they complained that one of the children became addict, so they helped him to find treatment. Many times the people join the church that serve their needs. Why? The answer, because we saw Christ in them. Don't preach me about Christ, but show me Christ in your actions. Because actions speak louder. What I would benefit if you start preaching me about faith, doctrine, but your actions are something different. Let me see Christ in your actions first. I'm not, by the way, belittling the importance of preaching. I'm preaching right now. But I am saying, if all this preaching and if all these activities are not supported by attending to the needs of the people, it is in vain. It is in vain. In Matthew chapter 25, the Lord actually made it very clear what is the main difference between the righteous and the wicked. What is the main difference between the sheep and the goat? One thing, these people felt and they had compassion for others, felt their needs, went out of their way to help and support them. But the wicked, they were self-centered. They did not go and reach out to the hungry, the thirsty, those who are in prison, those who are sick, the strangers, etc. So, we spoke about the importance of serving one another. Then, the second point, how can we serve one another? In what spirit we should serve one another? The first principle in serving one another is with love. With love. The motive should be love. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 3. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Here we see in this verse a person who used all his money to feed the poor. And in service, he traveled from one place to another place until his body is burned. But he doesn't have love. That's why St. Paul said, it profits me nothing. Why love is very important? Maybe I am motivated by my pride to show off, so the people actually may speak about how I am serving them. So all this service is coming from prideful heart, showing off. It's nothing. It profits me nothing. Maybe I'm serving others, But I am motivated with guilt. I feel guilty. So to get rid of this guilty feeling, I'm going and serving them. But I'm not happy. I feel guilty because the commandment said so. So I feel maybe God will not have mercy on me if I don't do it. That's why St. Paul, when he spoke about giving, he said, not out of compulsion and not out of sorrow, because God loves a cheerful giver. So it's very important when I serve others, I serve them joyfully, because I love to do this. My pleasure in serving others. My pleasure, as St. Paul said, I spend and be spent. I spend and be spent, anfiq wa anfiq. And he was doing this, you know, with love in his heart. Also, another important feature in how we serve, we should serve with humbleness. And here the Lord, actually, when he washed the feet of the disciples, he told us, when you serve others, don't make them feel that you are higher than them and they need you and you are like benefactor to them, helping them. And when you serve them, you serve them as debt, so they will be indebted to you. This is not the service, spirit of service. When I visit somebody in prison, when I visit somebody who is sick, when I host a stranger, when I help a new family to be established, it is not a debt. God loves a cheerful giver. I am doing this, I'm expecting nothing in return. I'm doing this with all humbleness. I am doing this, and I don't feel superior to them. But actually, they are superior to me, because they are Christ, and I'm serving Christ in them. They are Christ, indeed they are Christ. Like when St Pishoy washed the feet of this person, he was Christ. And when he carried the old man, he was Christ. Also, when we serve others, we should serve them without grumbling, without complaining. Many times when we serve, we complain. We complain about the behavior of the needy, the attitude of the needy, how they are demanding. St. Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 9, he told us, be hospitable to one another without grumbling. Be hospitable, show hospitality, generosity to one another without grumbling. Grumbling reflects a heart that is not full of love. When we complain and complain and complain about the needy and about their attitude, actually we will not be blessed. Because again, God loves a cheerful giver. Also, if we are serving joyfully and cheerfully, we will not actually reach a moment in which we will feel tired or will say, enough is enough, I don't want to serve anymore, I am fed up. St. Paul in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, he told us, bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. When I carry your burden and you carry my burden, you are fulfilling the law of Christ. And by the way, burden means a heavy load. That's what burden is. So when he said, bear one another's burden, بالعربي أخطال, it's a heavy load, and so fulfill the law of Christ. In the same chapter, in verse 9, he said, let us not grow weary while we are doing good. Don't say, I am tired, it's enough. I am fed up from these people and their attitude. They are demanding. No. Don't let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, we shall reap if we don't lose heart. If you don't lose heart in service, and you continue to serve others joyfully and cheerfully, then in the second coming of Christ, that is the due season, we will shall reap. God actually will reward us. Yes, God will reward us here on earth with many blessings, but the true reward will be the heavenly reward. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. And then St. Paul continues and says in verse 10, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. St. Paul is saying, whenever you have opportunity, do good to all. To all means to the believers and to the non-believers, to the Christians and non-Christians. But then St. Paul said, if the commandment is to do good to all, then with, in particular, especially to those who are of the household of faith, especially those who are our brethren in faith, Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Another important point in service, actually, our service should be complete, comprehensive, should cover every aspect. If God actually moved your heart to help somebody, don't help him partially, but try actually to help him in a comprehensive way. St. James spoke about this point. And he said, if a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? So if you do partial work with them, not a complete work with them, it doesn't profit anything. So we learn here how when we help one another, this help should be comprehensive. And the best example is a comprehensive service is the Good Samaritan. And by the way, the Good Samaritan helped a person who is considered an enemy to him. because there was enmity between the Jews and the Samaritans. But the good Samaritan helped this person. That's why the Jewish person saw Christ in the Samaritan. The Jewish saw Christ in this Samaritan. And that's what the Lord said at the end of the parable when he told them, which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And the answer, he who showed mercy on him. He who showed mercy on him. Another point, when we serve others, actually, we should know that service means sacrifice. Actually, service will be accepted as a sacrifice. So we should be willing to sacrifice in service. A good point in the parable of the Samaritan, Good Samaritan, we read on the next day when he departed, when the Good Samaritan departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. The Good Samaritan here represents the Lord Jesus Christ. And the 2 denarii represent the virtue of love. Number 2 usually represent love, because love usually is between 2. So here actually, the innkeeper are us, represent us. So Christ gave us his love, the 2 denarii. So when we experience the love of Christ, we can help others. And after giving him the 2 denarii, he asked him, now you have this love, take good care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. So here actually, the Good Samaritan is expecting the innkeeper to spend from his own pocket. That's why he told him, whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. Spending from my own pocket, that is a sacrifice. And why I am willing to sacrifice for others? Because I received the 2 denarii. I received the love of Christ in my heart. And then, when he will come again, in his second coming, he will repay us. As he repaid the sheep on his right hand, the righteous, when he told them, whatever you did with these little brethren, you did it with me. So, these are some aspects in the service. How, when we serve, we should serve with humbleness, we should serve with love, we should serve without grumbling, we should serve without losing heart, we should serve a comprehensive service, we should also sacrifice in our service. St. Paul, in his letter to Titus, chapter 3 and verse 14, says, and let our people also live to maintain good works, to meet urgent needs, that they may not be unfruitful. Many times we ask, how can I bear fruit in my life? What are the fruits that Christ is expecting from me? And here is the answer. When we learn how to maintain good words in serving one another, to meet urgent needs, then we'll be fruitful. Let our people also learn to maintain good words, to meet urgent needs, that they may not be unfruitful. Another aspect in service. Service is not only to provide for the needs of others, but actually should be in the field of human development. What I mean, human development. We should not only give the needy, but we should teach them how to depend on themselves. The first aspect is to provide for the urgent needs. But then we need to teach them how to depend on themselves, to train them to earn and learn some talents so that they can rely on themselves. Because St. Paul taught us, he who does not work, should not eat. I told you in the beginning, we need to be interdependent. But dependency is wrong. What do I mean dependency? When I live only dependent on others, others provide for everything I need. That's unacceptable. So when we help others, we help them in the urgent needs, and then we train them how to rely on themselves. Even in the monastic life, the angel appeared to St. Anthony and taught him how to weave baskets and to sell the baskets and to eat from the money that he will get from selling the baskets. Why? In order for St. Anthony and all the monks not to live dependent on others. God does not encourage laziness. And that's what we call human development. In serving the needy and in serving the poor, we need to develop them. Develop them means teach them and train them how to depend on themselves. That's why St. Paul differentiated between the burden and the load. When you go to Galatians chapter 6, I told you the burden is a heavy load. When he spoke about the burden, he said, bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. But when he spoke about the load in verse 5, he said, each one shall bear his own load. The load is your responsibility, how to depend on yourselves. And if you don't know how, here the church should train you and teach you how to carry your own load, how to be a responsible person, how not to live dependent on others. But when it comes to the burden, burden is a heavy load, you cannot carry it by yourself. It is what St. Paul said to Titus, the urgent needs. The burden, nobody can carry the burden by himself. That's why he said, you need to bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. So, if we are the children of St. Pishoy, let us walk in his footsteps. As I said at the beginning, St. Pishoy served others cheerfully and joyfully. Let us think about people whom God placed in our life, whether they are sick, whether they are strangers, whether they are in prison, whether they are needy. And think how to use your talent, your gift, in order to bear fruit, lest you become unfruitful. Go and serve them. Go and serve them with a spirit of love. Go and show them Christ who is in you, and you will see Christ in them as St. Pishoy saw Christ in these two persons, the person whom he washed his feet and the person whom he carried on his shoulder. Indeed, these two persons were Christ who appeared to St. Pishoy. As each one has received a gift, ministering to one another as good steward of the manifold grace of God. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.
I'm going to go to the next one.